The Holy Gospel according to Mark, the first chapter. Now after John was arrested, Jesus came to Galilee, proclaiming the good news of God, and saying, "The time is fulfilled, and the kingdom of God has come near. Repent and believe in the good news." As Jesus passed along the Sea of Galilee, he saw Simon and his brother Andrew casting a net into the sea, for they were fishermen. And Jesus said to them, "Follow me, and I will make you fish for people." And immediately they left their nets and followed him. As he went a little farther, he saw James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John, who were in their boat mending the nets. Immediately he called them, and they left their father Zebedee in the boat with the hired men and followed him. The Gospel of the Lord. And immediately we begin the sermon. It's kind of hard not to notice Mark's use of immediately throughout this whole gospel, especially when we hear it twice in just these few verses we had this morning. Mark is, as you know, the shortest of all four gospels, but it still covers nearly all of Jesus' life because the things in it happen so quickly, immediately, one after the other. In some ways, it's really easy for us to hear and understand this pace of immediately in Mark's gospel. But in other ways, it's really difficult for us to hear immediately. I believe you and I might be alike in how we hear this. You know, on one hand, there's definitely a sense of immediately in our world today. I, for one, as soon as I climb out of bed, feel like I'm immediately behind everything. I mean, there's diapers to be changed, a dog to be fed and walked. I gotta eat and get ready and get to work. I have tasks that need to accomplish. I have meetings to attend. I mean, most days I'm scheduling things down to the minute anymore. You know, I'll think things like, all right, I've got 3 minutes before I gotta get out the door to my next meeting. I bet I can get one more thing done. And that thing normally takes 5 or 10 minutes, so I'm immediately late. And if we do find ourselves with just a few minutes of nothing to do, we, what? Immediately reach for our phones, or our tablets, or our computers, just to check in and make sure we haven't missed anything, or to kill a little time while we have it. You know, we've been trained to feel lost or unproductive without the immediately. There was a study done a few months back where scientists would leave people alone in a room for anywhere from 6 to 5 minutes. 6 to 5 minutes, that was it, with nothing to do. No cell phone, no smartphone, no books, magazines, nothing. Except this one button, which, and they were warned about this, when they pushed the button, they would get shocked. Believe it or not, most participants in this study pushed the button and shocked themselves multiple times. The majority of people who were studied couldn't be left alone with nothing more than their thoughts for 6 to 15 minutes without some type of engagement or stimulation. And for them to begin to look for that distraction, even if it's an electric shock to themselves. I mean, we live in this immediately culture. But on the other hand, there's this other side to us. And I do believe it involves all of us. Because I've learned how you are, believe it or not. I've seen the sign in your home that says, "You can always tell a German, you just can't tell them very much." And I also recall being in a meeting very early on in my time here, discussing something of significant business and great importance, which we all knew was going to take a while, when in the middle of it, someone turned to me and said, "Well, just so you know, Pastor, us Germans take some time to ponder." I wrote that one down. And I've certainly found it to be true in this past year and a half. But I'll also admit that I must be German too, because there's usually no immediately in any of my decision-making abilities. For one, you know, my call story to get to where I am today is more like Jonah's than it is like those fishermen that were called by Jesus. You know, hearing God's call and running the other way, questioning God's motives, having to be swallowed up and spit back out before finally following through with this calling, all the while being very skeptical of what God was up to along the way. Even with my smaller day-to-day decisions, anyone who knows me well could tell you that decision-making is not my strong suit. Those things take time, you know. You know, put me in between two restaurants and tell me to pick one for lunch. Well, we're going to be there for a few minutes. You know, putting the word decision and immediately in the same sentence just sends chills down my spine. Which is why all of our readings today make me pause and wonder, both in amazement and disbelief, at the immediately, at how everything occurs. In that piece of Jonah's story that we hear, he preaches one of the shortest sermons of all time. He says, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown. That's it. And Nineveh listens. A city that was so unreligious that God considered destroying them. A city that wanted nothing to do with this God of Israel, after an 8-word sermon, believes in God. Don't you wish more sermons were like that? One sentence, and immediately everyone believes and repents and follows. And then we also hear about the start of Jesus' ministry. Mark's gospel, as we've heard over these past few weeks, takes us from baptism right to temptation, and then right to the start of his ministry, and right to the calling of his first disciples. Follow me, and I will make you fish for people. Okay, 10 words that time. But immediately, his disciples follow. They drop everything. Their careers, their livelihoods, their families, at the drop of a hat, at the drop of 10 words. So immediately, to follow this unknown, itinerant preacher who just happened to be walking by the lakeshore where they were all working. And then even Paul, in his very legalistic sounding letter to the Corinthians, talks about the appointed time growing short and the present form of the world passing away. Even he was on the immediately bandwagon. I mean, what would he think if he knew that 2,000 years later we were still part of this present form of this world, waiting for Christ's return? So again, to us, there's a part of this immediately stuff that sounds anything but believable. We need that time to ponder our decision. So in the midst of this immediately culture, I wonder if we follow God's call as immediately as Nineveh does, or as immediately as those disciples do. And I actually think we do. Now, following God's call to be disciples doesn't always mean drop everything and leave it all behind and go off to seminary or go off to some mission trip or some other kind of ministry. Sometimes, but not always. I mean, God calls everyone in very different ways. And sometimes we follow immediately, but sometimes it takes some pondering. But it's also quite important to remember that God's calling isn't always to doing something, but it's a calling to a new way of being. Mark's gospel reminds us that when Jesus comes onto the scene, immediately the world is different. The good news has arrived. It's taken flesh. It's dwelt among us. The kingdom has come near. Nothing is as it once was. So I think this image of fishing we get in the gospel is a really helpful one for this story. Not just because many of you here would drop everything immediately at the invitation of a fishing trip, But it helps us think that when a fish is caught, it's immediately dragged into a completely different world. It takes on a new identity. I mean, often that identity is dead, but the identity could also be the prize catch or the main course at a fish fry. So maybe we can see ourselves as the fish, being drugged immediately by Jesus into a new existence, dying to our old lives, wet from baptism, and obtaining a brand new identity as a child of God. Maybe we could see ourselves as Jesus' disciples, called to be fishers of people, not by having to add yet another task to our already busy lives, but having an entirely new life promised to us, a life as a beloved child of God, following Jesus because it's innate in us to do so. It's who we are. It's not what we have to do. Maybe we could see our lives of discipleship, these lives of following Jesus, not merely as a task we need to do for repentance or salvation, but as an identity that we've been given, having been saved by the grace of God. I believe there's a reason that both these stories begin around water. Jonah heard and followed God's word after being spewed out by the fish lying on the shores of the sea. You know, Jesus called Simon and Andrew and James and John out of their boats, out of the water, to follow him. And Jesus calls us to follow him out of those waters of baptism. It's in all of those waters where our old selves die, and we can turn to see the kingdom of God that's right before our eyes. Those waters are the starting point of Jesus' earthly ministry, and they're the starting point of our call stories and our new identities. That's the good news that we're called to be a part of. Will you follow?